today we're talking about regulation and the law. And as has become our tradition, we are going to start with a few definitions. Regulation, we're going to define for the purposes of this course as a rule or a directive made and maintained by an authority. And at this stage, it doesn't matter what authority that is. If it's your boss at work, if at work people have said that this is the way to do or not to do, that's how you need to behave. That's the rule. That's the regulation for the workplace. If it's what you're supposed to do in class, that's it. If it's at home, streets, I mean, there's the regulations all around us. And the law we're going to define for the purpose of this as a system of rules recognized by a country or community. And the key feature that we're going to be looking at here is that it's meant to keep the members in check and is enforced by the imposition of penalties.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's by way of definitions. If there was no threat of a punishment or promise of a reward, would we comply with rules and regulations? And it's a very important question as we start this topic, because that's really where this whole thing is hinged on. It's hinged on,
very interesting,
are you actually doing this because somewhere looming over your head is a threat? Or
are you
is
doing
it something
you
coming
believe,
from within? I mean, some people actually stay on the straight and narrow because of their fear to go into jail, for example.
If it wasn't for the fear of jail, they'd be stealing and looting.
So the underlying question here is, are you conforming because of a threat and a promise? Or would you conform anyway because you believe, you know what, it's not like me to sleep around.
Oh.
It's not like me to murder. It's not like me to steal.
Fair enough.
And we just agreed that the question we'd left you with was to ask yourself, do you comply? Do you stay on the straight path because of the fear of the looming threat or the motivation or the promise of a reward? Or would you be that way regardless? And we want to work ourselves towards the kind of people who actually are motivated from within without regard to the threat or the promise. So we left you with that thought. And now let's just consider the regulations that we so don't want to comply to are actually 90%, if not 100% of them, are actually made and put in place in order to protect us. Okay? And yet somehow we just have this natural inclination to rebel. You know, how many times do we only pull a seatbelt when we see a cop on the road? And yet the seatbelt idea
is there to save our lives.
It's just to save us. How many times do we try and get away with having a little more alcohol than is allowed in our system as we drive? And yet the whole area of driving under the influence is to protect us. Speed limits. How many times do we drive above the limit? And yet the whole idea of limits is to protect us. So the thing to do in this area is to come back and look and take a critical look at your natural inclination to rebel and ask yourself as you do your stop analysis, you know, why am I really doing this? And open your eyes again, refresh yourself, remind yourself that actually all these things are for my own good.
Mm.
So that's one thing that we need to keep reminding ourselves. And this is more important if you consider regulation and the law, because it also helps you even when you are in a position where there's conflict between you and someone else and it has to be arbitrated or it has to go to court. Remind yourself that even as someone is guilty or has done something wrong, you know, you ask yourself, why is it that there's a lawyer who wants to act on their behalf, wants to defend them? And you then have the soberness, you have the equilibrium to understand that the reason that someone who has killed another person has a lawyer and is entitled to that is actually to entitle them to a fair trial, not to try and prove that they're innocent. So the real premise, I think what has happened is that we've all forgotten the actual premise upon which most of these systems have been put in place.
Let me ask you, Zweli, why is it important for us to assess this area of our lives? Apart from just, if we do assess and say, okay, maybe I'm doing these things because of the promise of reward or the repercussions.
The reason it's important is because there's a guilt threshold, a point at which you start to feel guilty. So there's things that we consider petty in our own interpretation. So stealing sugar from the kitchen, no big deal. A hand in the cookie jar,
no big deal.
But a hand in the till, that starts to be something.
Starts to be a big deal.
So in that continuum of activities, there's a point which is your guilt threshold at which you start to feel, you know what, this now deserves some punishment. For this, I should be culpable. And that point differs for different people. And the more you ignore this area, the more that threshold rises.
Mm.
You keep getting away with more drastic, you know, more draconian, you know, for lack of a better word, I'll call them transgressions.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, before you realize it, you've actually gotten into very, very big crime.
Let me ask an interesting question when you mentioned that to something even like relationships. You cheat once, you get away with it. You cheat again. Then maybe when you're married, it doesn't seem so serious. So you even cheat within the marriage because a relationship is different from a marriage. Yeah. It shouldn't be really for moral compass or whatever. Yeah. But then you begin to think that you can get away with more and more. Yeah. Would that be a fair assessment on my side?
In fact, that is bang on. Because if we look at the relationship area and we look at something like adultery, it might not be a criminal offense, but it's a moral offense.
Yes, of the worst kind.
Yeah. Okay. And most of us will consider that that's no big deal. And from there, you go further and further.
Is that because you can't be put in prison for it? Is that because it's not illegal? So we justify
it's
it.
It's not criminal.
Mm. It's not criminal.
Mm. Yeah.
Maybe it's illegal. Some places it's definitely illegal. Anyway.
But the whole thing is that, you know, it has, remember when we defined the law, we said that there is imposition of penalties. The aggrieved party can actually sue for damages,
right,
even in adultery. But that's not really what we're worrying about here. We're worrying about the fact that, you know, we're going back to our original question. Are you conforming because of the looming threat of the suit for damages? Or are you conforming because within you, you have decided that you're going to reprogram yourself? And that's what STOP is all about.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to reprogram yourself to conform with those values. You can see now that everything is linked to the other.
To the
you know,
other.
Remember, we're talking about standards and values.
Yes.
So if that's your value system, now you're looking at the law and you're saying, yes, actually this value agrees with or is aligned to the law. So you start to see that actually as an upright citizen, you know, I'm not upright because when people are looking, that's what they think. I'm upright because that's how I am. And it's important for us to know that.
What does that realization do for someone?
A number of things. The first thing that it does is it frees up your mind to be more effective, because if you always, as you know, you gave us an example of someone, for example, is cheating in a relationship, you have to use another part of your brain to remember that in case I met this person in public, or in case someone asks me where were you, you know, have a standby or a plan B statement to make just in case.
Mm.
Okay, because you know you did something wrong. So that you are expending some of your cerebral capacity, so to speak.
To covering
up
your cheating.
And yet you could actually just free that up by just staying on the straight and narrow, and you'll actually use all your energy just to become more effective.
Wow.
So we've talked about that. It's important. You were asking me, why is it important to actually address this area of your life? And we said, yes, you know, the brain is engaged in so many things and you need to free up some of these processes that just waste your brain.
All right.
So that you can dedicate yourself to something more important.